nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 410. So last time we were talking about the error associated with finite element methods, and now we're going to actually apply it to a practical problem, which is an FEM waveguide mode solver. So we can use the beam propagation method to solve for the modes of a waveguide system. And the easiest way to do that is by propagating in the imaginary direction, which may not be obvious, but basically what it allows us to do is to take a guess solution, which may have multiple modes, and then to attenuate some of the modes faster than others. So we're just left with kind of our core solution. And so the way we do it is actually fairly simple. So first we take the fairly complex beam propagation methods, which included first and second derivatives and z, drop all those derivatives, and then just keep this equation here, which kind of looks like a spring equation for a harmonic oscillator. And then we can actually write down the propagation in the z direction in this way, which is here. And so you can actually see it's fairly complex. Depends on the effective refractive index, which we don't necessarily know in advance. And then we actually would substitute a special value of delta z, which would actually offset this n effective squared minus n naught squared, so that we could have a smooth propagation and only survive one mode as we propagate through a few steps in delta z. And so, of course, there's a big catch, which is we don't know the effective mode value, and therefore we don't know delta z. So what we have to do actually is just assume the largest index possible. So usually it would be the core index of a fiber optic waveguide, or if it was a photonic crystal waveguide, it might be the largest index on the outer region. And then we can decrease that as we need to, because it would never increase beyond the highest value. And so then eventually, after enough time, propagation in the z direction, in imaginary direction, then we get basically an effective refractive index that should be fairly consistent, so it should stop changing as we converge on delta z. The other thing we can do actually is once we have that first solution for the first mode, then we can orthogonalize any other solutions that we come up with using the Gram-Schmidt procedure. And the Gram-Schmidt procedure, also widely used in quantum mechanics, we would take some sort of trial solution, and then that trial solution would be projected onto the solution we just found for the first mode. And then we would subtract the projection of the trial solution onto the first mode from the trial solution. So anything that was left over would be purely along the lines of other possible solutions. And then we can repeat that over and over again with high accuracy. So just take a simple example of a waveguide that we might be interested in. Here we have a square index guided waveguide, which has dimensions of 1.5 by 3 microns, and it has a slight refractive index contrast with its surroundings, 3.26 to 3.2. And we assume that the wavelength we're interested in is 1.3 microns, and that the waveguide is essentially semi-infinite. And so we can basically use triangular elements in the cross-sectional plane, because this is effectively a 2D simulation with z propagation. So we just choose a PML value that's enough to reduce reflections to very small values. We can make it 10 to the minus 100, or even larger value is totally fine. And then we'll vary delta z to find the effective indices. And so then this showing like what the spatial profile looks like if you plot in the x direction, y direction here, and then the value of the field as calculated on this triangular mesh. And so using about 12,800 triangular elements with first order accuracy, so basically linear, then we can get what looks like a fairly accurate solution in x and y. And not surprisingly, it kind of looks like a cosine function in the x and y directions. And so if we plot the numerical loss associated with different delta z values for the propagation step, then you can see that for TE and TM, it's actually varying quite a bit, but you can see actually TE is flatter than TM. So that just gives us a rough idea of, you know, what are some reasonable ranges of step sizes that we might want to use. In the next lecture, we'll actually explain more details about how we can check the accuracy of these kind of results.